Welcome back. Thank you so much for sticking with us and completing that quiz. You're halfway there and setting Guinness World Record. We're going to kick off the second half with Ian. He has muscular dystrophy, and he's going to show us some of the technology that he's invented. Helps to keep him independent, working, and continue to lead a busy life as an entrepreneur and an innovator. Hope you enjoy this video.
Okay. Ian Price is the type of guy who doesn't let anything get in his way of doing something. Confined to a chair and dependent on a ventilator, thanks to a form of muscular dystrophy, he needs round-the-clock care. But he doesn't always want the attention. Case in point, he can't swallow and needs to have his mouth cleared of saliva frequently. In the past, that required human help to get a tube in his mouth. That wasn't good enough for Price, who invented a retractable straw that he can control through the use of his thumb.
I don't have to ask somebody every 15, 20 minutes to give me a hand, turn it on, and put the suction straw in my mouth. It's similar to a dentist's office, really. And so being able to do it on my own is a huge freedom, and definitely the independence is increased by doing that.
Price needs the straw even more frequently if he's talking to an inquisitive TV host. A web designer by trade, he developed the device with some initial help from his dad, a retired helicopter engineer.
Took about a year in the making, and I've had it on my chair for over a year, almost a year and a half now, and that's been absolutely amazing. Now I'm at the point of looking at redesigning it, making it smaller, more affordable, and then moving forward from that point.
As the founder of ICANN Resource, Inc., Price hopes to sell the retractable oral suction tube, or C9000 assistive device, as it's officially called, to other people in a similar situation.
I do have a patent on it, yes. Right now I'm working with a couple of universities with their engineering students, and hoping to bring it to the next level, and then I will be able to bring it to the market. ALS, MS, there's a wide variety of other neuromuscular disorders and other spinal cord injury, for instance. So I think that the market is, it's a fairly niche market, but as long as I can help out people, then I'll be happy.
You can find out more about the product at ICANNResourceGroup.com. Muscular dystrophy is certainly a debilitating disease. It's a genetic neuromuscular disorder that weakens the body's muscles. Price has a form called spinal muscular atrophy, type 2.
Only have the movement of my thumbs. That's about it right now. On the ventilator, I've been ventilator dependent for about going on 3 or 4 years now, and I'm unable to swallow, which means I can't eat. I haven't been able to eat anything for roughly 15 years.
Nothing, it seems, slows this guy down. The 31-year-old has 4 other jobs, is on the board of directors of several companies, and volunteers in the community. Now you can add inventor and entrepreneur to that list.
You know, I think both Ashley's video and Ian's video really hammer home the power of do-it-yourself assistive technology and the difference it can make in people's lives. Now we're going to shift gears and dive a little bit deeper into the world of making. I would like to introduce Jake, our engineering lead. He's going to get you started on 3D printing, which is one great way where you can make your own do-it-yourself assistive technology. Here's Jake.
Hey, my name is Jake McCotter, and I'm a mechanical engineer at Neil Squire and Makers Making Change. In this section, we're going to talk about 3D printers and how they can be used to create DIY assistive technology. DIY AT can be created using a variety of different tools. Some of these can be found in your house, while others may be available at your school, a library, or a community makerspace. In this section, we're going to focus on 3D printers. By the end of this section, you'll be able to describe what a 3D printer is and how it works, list 4 important settings for 3D printers, list 3 reasons that 3D printers work well for creating DIY AT, and describe the overall process required to create DIY AT using a 3D printer. Let's start by taking a look at what 3D printing is. A 3D printer creates a 3D object from a digital file. 3D printing is an additive manufacturing method. Traditional subtractive manufacturing methods, like using a mill or a lathe, start with a big block of material and slowly cut material away. Whereas additive manufacturing, like 3D printing, starts with some starting material and builds an object up from nothing layer by layer. There are many different types of 3D printing technology. Some of these can be as little as a couple hundred dollars, while complicated industrial machines can be upwards of a million. The most common type of consumer 3D printer is fused filament fabrication, or FFF. They may also be referred to using the trademarked term FDM, or fused deposition modeling. Since neither of those terms really roll off the tongue, we'll just use the term 3D printer from now on. These 3D printers are basically a computer-controlled hot glue gun. Plastic filament is fed into and heated inside the extruder and then pushed out a small nozzle. The narrow bead of melted plastic is deposited on the print bed as the nozzle moves. The plastic hardens as it cools, and then once a layer is complete, another layer is deposited on top, and this process is continued until the object is completed. There are several steps to go from an idea to a 3D printed object. First, the initial idea must be digitized and created into a digital file. This is typically done using software called Computer Assisted Design, or CAD. From the CAD model, a 3D model can be exported. It's commonly referred to as an STL. Once we have our 3D file, we use another program called a slicer. This process divides the model up into thin layers and creates G-code, or the 3D print file that the printer can then understand. When we give this information to the printer, it takes those instructions and creates our 3D object. Now that we talked about the basic operation and the overall process of 3D printing, let's talk about a few important settings. There are lots and lots of different settings, but here are some of the most important for 3D printing: layer height, support, infill, and perimeters. Layer height determines how many slices the model is divided into. On consumer printers, this typically varies from about 0.05 millimeters to 0.3 millimeters. More layers means smoother surfaces, but more print time. And generally, fewer, thicker layers leads to stronger parts than many thin layers. Support is a thin, breakable print structure that is removed and discarded after printing. Models with overhangs larger than about 45 degrees will require support structures. If these models are printed without support, it may print poorly or not at all. When a model is sliced into layers, the slicer treats the perimeters and the interior separately. This provides a way to optimize print time, material usage, and strength. The interior is filled with material referred to as infill. More infill makes for a stronger, heavier part, but takes longer to print and requires more material. The thickness of the walls is determined by the number of perimeters. A greater number of perimeters leads to a thicker wall and stronger part, but this does use more material. Now that we looked at 3D printing and some of the important settings, let's discuss why 3D printers are a good option for DIY AT. 3D printing is a good option for DIY AT for several reasons. First, they're cost effective. Both the equipment and the raw materials are relatively inexpensive. Second, 3D printers are ever more commonly available in all kinds of places, from your house, to your school, to your library, to makerspaces. Most people can find a 3D printer that they can access. Third, while it's not the fastest production method, you can go from an idea to a printable, testable object all within a period of about one day. Fourth, 3D printers are good for small quantities. You don't have to change any tooling or molding, they're just ready to go. And finally, they require minimal operator skill. Unlike some equipment that require years of training, pretty much anyone can operate a 3D printer, and it can do so largely unattended. Next, let's talk about the printing process for DIY AT. First, we need to find or create a digital file. There are lots of places to find files, and the process to create a digital file isn't that complicated. Second, we may need to modify or customize the design. Third is the actual printing process. Fourth, we do any post-processing or assembly steps. And then fifth, we test our device and share it with others. There are a number of repositories specifically for DIY and open source assistive technology. Some of them are listed here. These services also provide a platform for connecting with makers and volunteers to create devices that don't yet exist. There are also general 3D printing repositories that may have assistive technology. You can find a list of those in the resource section. While there are a large number of designs already available, you may be looking for something that doesn't yet exist. In this case, you'll need to create the digital files or pair up with someone who has the skills to do so. Designs can be created digitally using CAD software, computer-aided design, or computer-aided drafting. There are a variety of CAD programs, both free and commercial. You can find a list of different CAD software in the resources section. The ability to customize assistive technology is important for both function and user adoption. Some changes, like picking a desired color, are typically easy, while other changes may be more challenging depending on the design. Once you're ready to print, you have several options. First, if you have a printer or have access to one, you can print the design yourself. You also may be able to pair with a volunteer to do the printing on your behalf. And finally, you can use a commercial 3D printing service, though this is typically the most expensive option of the three. Once you have your printed parts, there may be some additional steps before it's ready for use. You may need to remove any support material, smooth any sharp edges or corners, and add any necessary hardware or additional components. Once everything is assembled, it's time to test out your design. While we've shown it here as a set of linear steps, oftentimes this is an iterative process, and you may need to refine things and do additional prints. Once you're happy, please share that design with others so they can benefit as well. This provides a way to get feedback to improve designs and help support the open source sharing model. In this section, we learned about 3D printers and how they can be used to create do-it-yourself assistive technology. 3D printing is a manufacturing method for creating 3D objects from digital files. Fused filament fabrication type printers deposit plastic in thin layers using a heated nozzle. Four of the important settings are layer height, support, infill, and perimeters. We discussed a bunch of different reasons why 3D printing is a good option for DIY AT, including how it's quick and cost effective. We listed several repositories where you can find freely available designs, and we covered the overall process, finding or creating the files, customizing, 3D printing the parts, any post-processing and assembly steps, and then testing and sharing. We hope you enjoyed this section.
Thanks, Jake. We've got one more video for you. Tyler, one of our Makers Making Change engineering interns who has been working with us over the last year. He's going to talk what it means to be a maker and how anyone can be a maker. He's even going to show you a bit on how to build one of our most requested devices, the LiftSync, a mouth-operated mouse. Here's Tyler.
I want to talk about my biggest passion in life, being a maker. But what does being a maker mean? We often think of inventors and big names like Nikola Tesla, Einstein, and Marie Curie. But what once was someone's crazy idea in their garage might be a device that you use every day now. Everyone knows a maker, and everyone is a maker themselves. Take a walk around your neighborhood, and you'll be able to see the influence of everyday makers. A maker is anyone that starts with an idea and turns it into something new. Of course, the great scientists, engineers, mathematicians are amazing makers. But so is your local artist, gardener, carpenter, mechanic, and everything else in between. Recently, I've been working as an engineering intern at Makers Making Change. This has allowed me to work a lot of my design skills and grow as an engineer. The program connects makers to people living with disabilities to create affordable and accessible assistive technology devices. Makers volunteer their time to design or build devices which go on to help people in their daily activities and interests. These animated clips are from a video that goes into a little bit more depth about what Makers Making Change is and how it works. If you want to check out that video, it's in the description below. Let's take the Makers Making Change lip sync device, learn what it is and how to build it. Think of it as a mouse for your mouth. It's used to control different digital devices that some people may struggle to use due to limited mobility. The lip sync allows the user to move a cursor across the screen, as well as left and right clicking by breathing in and out or sipping and puffing. To build the lip sync, we need makers just like you. Let's break it down into a three-stage process. 3D printing. soldering and assembling the electronic components, and programming the lip sync. The build process is always challenged by choice. Every maker ends up being part of the bigger picture. So if you feel like this is all a bit too much right now, that's totally fine. The best way to get involved is just by checking out the Makers Making Change website and signing up. But let's get building our lip sync. I use what's called an FDM printer, which means that I can take a 3D model from my computer, use a slicer software to convert the 3D image to a language that the printer can understand, and hit print. Layer by layer, the print builds up from plastic that has been heated and laid out in a very specific pattern to result in the same 3D model that we sliced. Once all the prints are complete, we can move on to the electronics. It's always a good first step to lay out all the parts to make sure you have everything. We're going to assemble all these parts together by a process called soldering. Soldering is done by heating up a metal alloy called solder, where it flows onto the part and solidifies quickly. In this case, it's being used to assemble various boards, resistors, and other components of the lip sync. Then just like that, you have all of the hardware assembled. But right now, we can't really do much with the lip sync, because it hasn't been given any instructions to tell it what to do. That's where programming comes in. To do this, we can pull up a software called Arduino. It's actually the same company that makes the boards that run the lip sync. Now there's already some code that's been made for us by some brilliant minds at Makers Making Change, so we can just download that right from the website and send it over to the lip sync. Now we have a fully functioning device that can go to a user who needs it. Detailed instructions on how to build the lip sync or any other devices can be found on the Makers Making Change website. Being a maker doesn't come without its challenges. Sometimes it can feel like you're stuck or that you can't do something, no matter how hard you try. But if you follow your passion and keep learning, you'll change the world.
Thanks, Tyler. And that's it for the lesson. We got one more thing we need you to do. It's a final quiz. Fill that out, and that submits you as participating in our Guinness World Record attempt. After that, you should tell all your friends. They want to be part of a Guinness World Record too. Help us set a new record. On behalf of everyone at Neil Squire Society and at Makers Making Change and all of our partners, thank you so much for your interest in our work and helping us raise awareness how assistive technology can empower people with disabilities. We couldn't do it without you. Thank you so much.